गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वी वेर डूइंग अकाउंटिंग फॉर बैंकिंग कंपनीज, राइट? इन आवर फर्स्ट टू सेशंस वी हैव डेल्ट इन विद फीचर्स ऑफ बैंकिंग कंपनी, राइट? हाउ बैंकिंग कंपनी ऑपरेट्स, हाउ टू कैलकुलेट नेट प्रॉफिट ऑफ बैंकिंग कंपनीज, एंड देन वी डिड वन ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ वन स्पेसिफिक आइटम, दैट इज हाउ टू कैलकुलेट रिबेट ऑन बिल डिस्काउंटेड. सो दिस इज द सेकेंड टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन, दैट इज इनकम रिकॉग्निशन. What is the method of accounting banking companies follow? Usually, income means interest income on loans and advances, basically lending part. On the amount lent, bank gets interest, right? So there are different types of loan, that is term loan, then it can be cash credit, bank overdraft, right? So there might be a case that customers are not paying the EMIs right on time. Suppose one customer has taken an overdraft facility and that particular person is not paying the interest on that overdraft timely. So in that case, such loans and advances will be treated as non-performing, right? So loans and advances are further classified. I repeat, loans and advances in an asset for the banking companies, right? This is the amount lent. Now, depending upon their payment pattern, whether they are regularly paying or whether there is any defaulter, right? These loans and advances are further classified into two categories. One is performing assets and another one is non-performing assets, right? So in simple terms, if I tell you interest / principal are repaid on time, here interest / principal is overdue for a period of more than 90 days. For different types of loans and advances, there are different types, criteria to identify such loans and advances as non-performing. This is for basically simple term loan. So if interest, principal or both is overdue for a period of more than 90 days, then that particular loans and advances is non-performing, means the customer is not paying us the EMIs, the installment amount on time. So that particular loans and advances which the bank has, right, it's an asset for the bank, will be treated as non-performing asset. So loans and advances on which we are getting the installment timely, fine, within the due dates, that is performing. Loans and advances on which the installment or the EMI, whatever you call, is not received timely and it's overdue for a period of more than 90 days. Suppose a loan is an agricultural loan. So in that case, the criteria to decide non-performing is different. In case of long duration crop, the principal or the interest is due for one crop season. And in case of short duration, the principal or interest is due for two crop seasons. In case of bank overdraft and cash credit, there is a different criteria to determine non-performing. That I will discuss later on. But we are dealing with income recognition. Income, what is an income for the bank? Interest income on loans and advances given to the customer. So the customers are supposed to repay the principal or interest or both right on time. So if they are paying within the due dates, fine, performing asset. If they are not paying, then it's non-performing. So non-performing assets are those loans and advances given to the customer on which the installment is overdue for a period of more than 90 days. So, method of accounting you will follow. For performing assets, we are going to follow accrual basis of accounting. What are we going to follow? Accrual basis of accounting, right? And for non-performing asset, we are following cash basis of accounting. Is that fine, everyone? Right? So for performing assets, we will record interest income on accrual basis, and for non-performing, because it is overdue for a period of more than 90 days, so there is a chance you may not receive. So only when you receive it, then only you can show it as an income. So let us do one problem and then we will move ahead. Okay? So let us deal with question number 8. Just read it once. Find out the income to be recognized for the year ended 31st March in respect of interest and advances as below. So there are three types of loan. Few term loans are performing, few term loans are non-performing. Few cash credits are performing, few cash credits are non-performing. Few bill purchase and discountings are performing and few are non-performing, right? So first of all, we will write the principal, right? That interest on performing assets are recognized on accrual basis, whereas interest on non-performing asset are recognized under cash basis. So with respect to performing and non-performing, they have told how much is earned and how much is received. So what are we going to do? We are going to prepare one statement, particulars interest earned on performing asset interest received on non-performing asset. Is that fine? So on term loan, with respect to performing asset, I will take earned one. And with respect to non-performing, I'll take the received one. On cash credit / OD, with respect to performing, I will take the earned one. With respect to non-performing, I will take the received one. On bill purchased and discounted, with respect to performing, I will take earned, with respect to non-performing, I'll take received. So here comes 2040, right? And here it is 74. So therefore, total interest to be credited to PL is equals to, it is 2040 plus 74, and you know you have to show interest earned under which column? Interest income. I just told you in last class Schedule 13, that is rupees 2114. I guess this is absolutely fine. This I will add up. Everyone okay? I guess there is no such problem with that. You can prepare the total column and you can just add it vertically as well. Row wise addition also you can do. Now, usually what happens, you must have seen that normal case may we create provision on debtors. How do you create? Say for example, these are my list of debtors. Right? This is say credit allowed, say 30 days, 40 days, 50 days, 10 days. There are different types of business relationship we can have with different types of customer. There is no problem in that. Currently overdue for means bill pending for, overdue you cannot write, you write bill pending for, payment pending for. So you can see that currently this is overdue, this is also overdue, and this is also overdue. Further, you are going to check average past payment period. Basically, in past, it pays around 55 to 60 days. So fine, he will pay us, not a problem. His is 60 days, his is 25 to 30 days. So in that case, the major concern would be our this particular customer who is currently overdue. As per as past experience also, he is overdue. So this puts up our emphasis that on this debtor, we should create a provision. Who decides this provision? Read the management. The management of the company, the board of directors. But in case of banking companies, it is not the board of directors who will decide the provision rate. It is the RBI who has prescribed that if the loan is performing, what would be the provision rate? Very nominal, 0.40%, 0.40%. And if it is non-performing, then the provision would be this. And all these guidelines will be prescribed by RBI. You do not have to bother. Normal case may you prescribe the amount of provision to be calculated on debtors by seeing who are currently overdue, by making an analysis of average past payment period, right? So you understand ki who is actual big matter of concern. So on that we record say around about 20-30% provision. एंड रिमेनिंग पे वी इन जनरल वी क्रिएट 5% प्रोविजन, राइट? बट इन केस ऑफ बैंकिंग कंपनीज इट इज नॉट यू हु आर गोइंग टू डिसाइड द प्रोविजन परसेंटेज, राइट? बेसिकली दिस लोन्स एंड एडवांसेस इट्स व्हाट, इट्स अ डेटर फॉर मी, एसेट मीन्स डेटर बिकॉज आई हैव मेन बिजनेस इज माई मनी लेंडिंग, सो आई हैव लेंट मनी. In case of normal goods, you sell goods on credit, right? You are given money on credit. So that person is not about to repay you, but he haven't done it. So in case of debtors of a banking company, which is loans and advances, the provision rate will be prescribed by RBI, right? Now what is those provision rates that you have to remember? Time to time RBI changes it, right? So give the heading. Provision on advances. Now, before that, I have already told you that we have performing asset and we have non-performing. Now, non-performing is what? Overdue for a period of more than 90 days. Now it is further classified into three parts. One is substandard, another one is doubtful, and third one is loss asset. Recently RBI allowed to write off debts, right? Somewhere around 60,000 crores. So RBI has told to treat those loans and advances as loss asset. So on that 100% provision should be created. So for many years it is due and banking companies are showing it as an asset in their books. So there is no need. Suppose if someone has not paid you for the past 7 years, so no point, you won't recover. You know a lot of cases. I am not going to say the names on public platform, but you know who have taken loan from bank and those who haven't repaid, right? Big persons are there. So either the auditor or the RBI will guide that you should treat it as loss, so write it off, right? So on those assets, till auditor's recommendation or RBI guidelines, it has been identified as loss asset, so 100% provision. Now what about substandard and doubtful? Substandard are those which is in NPA category for a period of less than or equal to 12 months. Is that fine? So substandard assets are those assets which are in NPA category. This is a classification of NPA only. Which has remained in NPA for less than equals to 12 months. So if you see from due date, 90 days it is NPA category, it enters, and from there beyond 90 and up to 1, it is not from starting 1, first 90 days it will take to become NPA. Now it has entered into, from there it will be calculated within 12 months, if it is in within 12 months. Say for example, I am just giving you one example. Say the due date of installment is, due date of installment is say 10th September. So from here 90 days. So due date is 10th September, right? So till 90 days, if it is in NPA, so 91st date will become NPA. So tell me, as on 31st March, what is the status of these loans and advances? Right, on September you see 20 days, October is 31, November is 30. So this comes to 81. This is September, this is October, this is November. Right? So 20, 31, 30 days, okay, fine, 20 days, okay, 31 in October, so it comes to 81. It means 9th December, it becomes NPA, right? NPA classified as NPA, 81 plus 9, so 9th December it is NPA. Now as on 31st March it is within 1 year of NPA, so this particular will be, this particular loans and advances will be classified as substandard asset. Still nothing has been received. So next year 31st March, 1 year plus NPA, so it will enter into doubtful category. Say for example, I give the date 17. So as on when I prepared the balance sheet as on 31st March 2018, so this will be regarded as NPA substandard. When I prepared 31st March 19, now it is more than 1 year in NPA, so it will become doubtful. This is very important. Is that fine? Just have a look. Is that fine? So, like this, we are going to check as on year end what is its status. Anyway, what is doubtful? If it has remained in NPA for more than 12 months. Further, it can be of three types: less doubtful, average doubtful, high doubtful, like that. So we have doubtful up to 1 year. Then we have doubtful 1 to 3 year. Is that fine? So each loans and advances will be classified. It is in which stage, right? Now let us talk about the provision part. For loss asset, I have told you 100%. For performing asset, it is 0.25% It will be 0.25%, right? Commercial real estate sector, 1%, and for others it is 0.40%. Is that fine, I guess? On total outstanding. For substandard, you need to calculate the secured and the unsecured part. So secured part is 15%, unsecured is 25%. For infrastructural loans, escrow account, it is 20%. Doubtful. Secured up to 1 year is 25%. Secured from 1 to 3 year is 40%. And secured 100%. And in all these cases, unsecured portion, we create provision of 100%. Now, what is this secured, unsecured? Basically, whenever you give loans and advances, whenever bank gives loans and advances, bank takes securities. So, to the extent of realizable value of security, such loans and advances will be treated as secured. So, this part you need to remember. On performing, it is on total outstanding, irrespective of security value. SME and agricultural sector, it will be 0.25. Infrastructural loan, 1%, and others it is 0.4. Substandard, we need to have secured and unsecured. Secured is 15%, unsecured is 25%, and escrow, that is infrastructural loan, right? It is 25%. Doubtful, on unsecured it's full 100, and secured up to 1 year, doubtful up to 1 year, secured portion 25%, 1 to 3 years secured is 40, like this, right? So note, secured portion means to the extent loan and advances is secured by realizable value of security held, not book value. Currently, what is the realizable value? On that basis, secured, unsecured will be determined. Is that fine, everyone? I guess there should not be any problem with respect to this discussion, right? So in exam, you might get a 5-mark problem asking you to create provision on loans and advances. So they will give you substandard, doubtful, loss, performing. So accordingly, you remember this percentage and you can make it. So let us see number 9, question number 9 in your study mat. जस्ट हैव अ लुक. क्वेश्चन नंबर 9. राइट, वेरी सिंपल. फ्रॉम द फॉलोइंग इंफॉर्मेशन ऑफ डिटेल्स ऑफ एडवांसेस ऑफ चंद्रा बैंक लिमिटेड कैलकुलेट द अमाउंट ऑफ प्रोविजन टू बी मेड इन प्रॉफिट एंड लॉस फॉर द ईयर एंडेड 31st मार्च. सो वॉट दे हैव सेड, रुपीज आर इन लैक्स, स्टैंडर्ड मीन्स परफॉर्मिंग, स्टैंडर्ड एसेट, परफॉर्मिंग एसेट सेकेंड नेम इज स्टैंडर्ड एसेट. ओके, सब स्टैंडर्ड, दे हैवंट सेड सिक्योर्ड और अनसिक्योर्ड, तो यू आर गोइंग टू अज्यूम सिक्योर्ड. डाउटफुल, दे हैवंट मेंशन्ड सिक्योर्ड और अनसिक्योर्ड, यू आर गोइंग टू अज्यूम सिक्योर्ड. So for 1 year you are going to create 25%, for 2 year you are going to create 40%, for 3 year also 40%, 1 to 3 is 40%, more than 3 is 100%, loss asset is 100%, right? So statement showing calculation of, if nothing is mentioned, we are going to assume it is secured. So question number 9, statement showing calculation of provision on loans and advances. We have assets percentage of provision amount rupees in lakhs, then provision also rupees in lakhs. Standard, I'll write all the name first. Then you have substandard, then you have doubtful, up to 1 year, you have 2 year one, you have 3 year one, then you have more than 3 year, and finally you have loss assets. Is that fine? So standard amount is 10,000. For substandard amount is 6,400. I'm just writing the amount of loans and advances. Doubtful, 1 year. Doubtful 1 year is 3,200. Doubtful 2 year is 1,800. Doubtful 3 year is 900. And doubtful more than 3 is 1,100. Loss asset is 3,000. Is that fine? So now, standard, it does not make any difference whether secured or unsecured, on total it is 0.4%. Substandard and doubtful, if nothing mentioned, I am going to assume secured. So substandard secured is 15%. Doubtful up to 1 year secured is 25%. Doubtful 1 to 3 year secured is 40%. Doubtful more than 3 secured is 100, and loss asset is 100. So 10,000 into 0.4 is 40. 15% of this is 960, 800. Then you have 720, 360, 1100, 3000. So this is the total provision required to be made. Total provision required on loans and advances. Six nine eight zero. Is that fine, I guess? There's no problem in that.